To me, DP means director of photography, not Tracy Lawrence.
So you seem like from first appearances, you would seem to be a master of havoc and explosions.
Yeah, I think a lot of people like to pigeonhole you and me and everybody. And funnily enough, I started in commercials. And I started at the BBC in documentaries and then went into drama at the BBC, which was very kind of typical British TV drama, which was, you know, Dickens and Shakespeare and things like that, and then into improvised drama. And then I thought, well, I want to direct, really, because I started in editing. And so I looked for a way to get into directing movies, and everyone in England seemed to be going through commercials. And they were big budget, shot on 35mm film, and they were glossy and much bigger than the TV shows, actually, that I was working on. So I started doing commercials. And then the only commercials I could see that had actors in them and stories and beginning and middle and end were comedy commercials. And so I ended up just doing comedy. And so for a few years, I was Mr. Comedy Commercial. And I came over to the States because the company I was working with had an office here. And they said, do you want to try out in LA? And I thought, well, LA is Hollywood, isn't it? So that's one step closer to movies. So I came and started doing comedy commercials here. And a lot of them got on the Super Bowl and became kind of big and in that world, and got the attention of Hollywood and producers. And so I started getting the calls. And I started getting offered lots of comedies because they saw my commercials.
So they thought you were going to be Jonathan Lim.
Yeah, and then Jerry Bruckheimer called me up. And he's seen another commercial I did that actually had a lot of action in it, jets and you know, things like that, which was kind of rare for me at the time, even though it had a comedy story running through it. And he said, you know, I really want to make a movie with you, and called me in and said, you know, he had a huge stack of scripts behind him. It was like a wall of scripts that he was obviously developing. And he turned around, he picked three at random, I think they were random, and sort of threw them across the desk at me and said, you know, read those this weekend and then tell me on Monday which one you want to make. And I think I had two other offers from other studios at the time. And as I said, they were kind of comedy or romantic comedies. And I read all of them. And then I read Jerry's scripts. And one of them was Con Air. And it was immediately appealed to me because, firstly, it wasn't really comedy. It was action. And I consciously didn't want to do a comedy movie. And but it had great characters. It was written by Scott Rosenberg, and it had fantastic, even the characters' names were great in it, and like Diamond Dog and Cyrus the Virus and you know, Sally Can't Dance and things like that. And so I was sort of in there, but it was written like a little independent film, but you know, it had this sort of action thread through it, you know, that Jerry Bruckheimer was known for. So came Monday morning, I signed on. I said, okay, I want to do this because I need a break from comedy, and this seems like a big fun action movie. And I didn't really know what I was letting myself in for, because I'd sort of done 5-day shoots at the most until then, and suddenly I was doing this huge action movie. Even though, you know, Jerry said, you know, pick all your favorite actors to be in it, so I didn't really go after action actors at that time. I went after all my favorite indie actors, you know, like John Cusack and Nick Cage, even at that time, was considered more indie. And, you know, Ving Rhames and John Malkovich. And I just populated with all my favorite indie guys.
And Buscemi, the most Steve Buscemi, scariest man in the world.
Yeah. And, and then, of course, you know, I found myself in the middle of this huge action movie. But even though it was an action movie, I couldn't actually help turning off the comedy muscle. So there's actually a lot of humor in it. So now I watch it and I think it's more of a comedy with action in it. So
when you started at the beginning, when you were doing editing at the BBC, I mean, did you want to be an editor, or
no,
did you?
No.
Was that just a way to get in the door?
It was just a way to get in. Because I was, you know, since 12 years old, I had my own little Super 8 movie camera and I wanted to make films. And but at that age, you don't really know what the different jobs are. You think, you know, you pick up the camera and you think you do everything. So, you know, I was looking for a way to get into the business. And at that time, there was no, there wasn't a lot of film schools in England. There was one film school, and they took 25 people a year, mostly post-grad. So, you know, most people there were sort of in their late 20s. And I was 18 and just wanted to get straight in the business. And the BBC had a film department that was enormous. They had 65 full-time camera crews, film cameramen, mm-hmm. and 120 full-time film editors, mm. and 30 or 40 freelancers. So it was a giant film department, and I think it shot more film than any other company in the world, including Bollywood, any single company at that time. And that was right before TV, especially in England, went over to tape and yeah. and what they used to call ENG, and then eventually digital. But at that time, it was all shot on film. And so I taught my way in there because I was sort of a film buff, hmm. and was technically very savvy on how films are made and everything. And they could see my enthusiasm, and so they let me join. And they trained me technically in all the different departments.
So what were you cutting on at that point?
16mm film.
Wow.
Yeah, we were actually cutting the film, and then, you know, then we would send it off for the negative to be cut, and then prints made from that, and then we would telecine it and mm. color correct it onto tape for broadcast.
So was that a good time for the BBC? I mean, you're kind of 25 years, 30 years younger than anybody we think of as being from that generation of guys who kind of came through there and, you know, mm. are still making movies, many of them, amazingly, in their 70s. But you were significantly younger. Was there a group of people that were emerging, or was it just kind of business over there?
Yeah, it was a very good time. I didn't realize how good the BBC was at that time. I mean, it was at its height in some ways, because mm-hmm. I think it was 25,000 people worked for the BBC mm-hmm. throughout the whole country. And because it was non-commercial, there was no pressure on audience ratings mm-hmm. in a way. There wasn't that sort of competition there is now, even now with the BBC. And so everything was done purely for the art of it, really. And mm-hmm. so it was a very small decision group. So there'd be the producer, the director, and you know, and the editor and the writer, maybe, you know, the only people involved in a drama production in that way, mm-hmm. in decision making. And so it was a very artistic environment, but you were having to produce this stuff to go out on air, so it had a deadline. It wasn't like right. being at film school. You had to get it done. And so it was a rarefied atmosphere. And I worked with, you know, some directors like Mike Lee was a director there at the time, and Stephen Frears.
So they were all still hanging around?
They were still there. And in fact, you know, Mike Lee, he seemed like a very old man to me when I was there, because I was 18, you know, but he probably was only in his 30s.
Wow.
When I worked with him. And, you know, I learned a lot.
Contagious at the time or no?
It was like the lower down you were, the nicer he was to you. So he was really nice to me, but to producers and anybody like that, he was terrible.
That sounds
and,
like
but he used to really make me the funniest man in the world. Yeah. And so that was a great training. And he taught me about improvised drama, which I use all the time now on set. You know, I really trust my actors. Mm-hmm. And when they come up with ideas, and I don't feel locked in by the script, mm-hmm. and I learned a lot there from him about that improvised drama. And before that, I learned a lot from documentaries, because mm-hmm. the thing about documentaries is it teaches you, when you're editing, to make a story out of what you have, not what you wanted to get or what you should have got, but what you actually have. Mm-hmm. You know, this is all you've got. This is what happened when you went there and shot the documentary. So now you make a story out of that raw footage. Mm-hmm. So I used you know, that knowledge. And then I also worked in Current Affairs, which was a daily news program that went out at 11 o'clock at night. And that taught me about deadlines and mm-hmm. working really fast and not panicking, because sometimes we would be editing the show while the titles were, you know, the music was running and the guy, right. the anchor man was introducing the item, and we were still editing it, and we'd have to run down the corridor, throw it on the machine, and hit go, and it would go out. And so
broadcast news.
It was exactly like that. And so from all those sort of BBC years, I learned various different things, which I still carry with me. And then with commercials, I went and sort of learned about corporations from them, because mm. when I started working with studios, I found them very similar to, you know, the big corporations. I'd done, you know, Levi's and Coca-Cola and Pepsi and people like that. Mm-hmm. The studios were quite similar to that sort of big corporation that you had to deal with, and your art came up against, you know, the sort of corporate party line, really.
So true when working for Jerry Bruckheimer, or less so?
Less so with Jerry, because he's sort of a law unto himself. So really, you know, he's your big brother that looks after you. So mm-hmm. That was great, because, and I didn't really appreciate it as much as I would now, because he was my first experience. I thought, oh, it's always going to be like this. You're always going to have this big godfather mm-hmm. looking after you, and he deals with the studio, and you just deal with making the film. And it hasn't really been like that since. You know, I've had to also deal with the studio, because, you know, he's he's a great big brother, as I said, and takes a lot of the weight off your back of you and gets what you want. And he's a director's producer in that way.
You know. So you go in not wanting to be typed as a comedy guy. You come out, I assume, not wanting to be typed as an action guy.
Yeah.
But tough, I would think, after a success like that.
Yeah, well, I mean, and I deliberately, the next film I took, you know, I got offered every film with either prisoners in it or airplanes or prisoners in airplanes or prisoners in submarines, whatever it was. It was the same thing. So I deliberately, when my second film, The General's Daughter, which was a dark drama, and
very dark drama.
Yeah, very dark, with no real action in it.
Yeah.
I deliberately went after that because I wanted to be, you know, seen as being able to do different things. Mm-hmm. And I really loved the story and I loved the book. And we went back into the book and sort of pulled a lot of the stuff in the script out of the book. And again, I brought Scott Rosenberg in, who did Con Air with me, to polish the script. And of course, when I read the book, I saw there was a lot of humor in the book. So we actually took a lot of the humor, even though it was a very dark story and it could have been very depressing. We actually put a lot of humor in. And with Travolta, you know, he can handle that sort of charming, you know, twinkle in the eye kind of humor. And it was a bit, I would say, nerve-wracking the first time I showed it to an audience, though, because it is a serious topic. You know, it's about a female army officer who's raped and killed in the army, and her father covers it up for the sake of the army and his reputation, and peppered with humor. You didn't know whether the two things were going to go. But in the end, I you know, the first 5 minutes, that, you know, it's very dark, and you think it's going to be no relief, and then Travolta walks on screen and he cracks a joke, and I felt the whole audience go, you know, and they really appreciated it. And then, you know, and then they realized that we were going to take them into scary, dark places, but we were going to relieve it every now and again. And so they relaxed and really enjoyed it. And even though it was, you know, a serious adult drama, it was released in the summer.
Yeah.
And it actually ended up having bigger box office than Con Air.
Well, Paramount was like known for Fatal Attraction at the time.
Yeah.
You know, it was that kind of cycle. And this movie was not that those movies. This was, you know, a step different than Basic Instinct or Fatal Attraction or any of those movies. And I think it kind of took people by surprise, but it did a lot of business.
Yeah, it kept the same every week. It was, I think it was like counter programming, because in the summer there's a lot of bubblegum roller coaster rides, and this was a serious drama. So, you know, it attracted a steady audience all the way through the summer, and it was very gratifying to me that, you know, that it did that something as serious as that would perform like that.
So does a town that likes to put people in boxes, could they figure out what to do with you at that point, or?
No, I mean, I think, you know, luckily, you know, the town recognizes success, and they don't, I don't know if they analyze it that closely, and they go, well, you know, and sometimes it's to their detriment, I think, that they go, well, he's successful, so What do you want to do? And so after that, I wanted to have some relief and some fun, and I've always been a sort of James Bond fan and that sort of thing. And then I was offered by Paramount, the same studio, because we'd had a good experience on The General's Daughter. They offered me Lara Croft Tomb Raider, and I thought, that's another, you know, I've proved myself on The General's Daughter. Now just go and have some fun and do something that's a bit more bubblegum, and you can just, you know, have gadgets and cars and.
Do you feel pressure in a situation like that, though? I mean, you had that movie got a lot of, because of the success of the video game and because of Angelina, there was a huge amount of attention on that before, you know, everybody's all frame of it. Is that pressure that you feel, or are you off doing your job and not thinking about it?
Yeah, I mean, I do know but I'm sort of dumbly naive, I've found, most of the time. Like, when I did my first film, I didn't realize how hard it was going to be until I was right in the middle of it, and then by that time, it's too late to get out of it. And I sort of go into denial, really, and think, oh yeah, I can do a video game into a film. And they say, well, it hasn't really worked before. And I said, oh no, I'm sure I can do it, you know. And so it's a sort of dumb naivety that I always had, that I just bluster in and think I can do it. And touch wood, a lot of the time I get away with it.
I don't remember what's next. I actually thought there was something between Tomb Raider and General's Daughter, but I guess not.
Well, actually, then I was going to do Black Hawk Down. Uh-huh. And I spent, again, with Jerry Bruckheimer, and we spent 10 years developing that. And it was kind of a real passion project, and I found the articles in the Cincinnati Inquirer, and I contacted the journalist, and I said, you know, I really want to make a film based on your articles of this incident. And he said, well, I'm writing a book as well. I said, well, we want to buy the book as well. So we did that, and I took it all around Hollywood, and nobody wanted to buy it. Every studio was too political, too expensive. And so then I called up Jerry, you know, and said, you know, and I pitched it to him like in 30 seconds on the phone. He bought it on the phone in 30 seconds because it's such a great story. And then, of course, we had to make it into a film, into a script. And, and that process, you know, took 2 years, and we still weren't happy with it. And so I said, well, we'll keep working on it. And I went off and did Tomb Raider. And then a few weeks, I think it was a couple of weeks, right before the end of shooting, I'd done like 100 days of shooting on Tomb Raider. I was absolutely exhausted, and I still had another week or two to go. And I'd been to Cambodia and Iceland and up mountains and, you know, every kind of action you could imagine. And Jerry's producers called up and said, we've got to go into production now on Thunder Run because there's a, Black Hawk Down because there's a SAG strike coming. And the SAG strike in commercials had lasted a year and a half. And they were saying, well, look, you know, it's coming in the summer. We've got 6 months to prep, shoot, and finish this film, get rid of the actors before this strike. And can you prep the movie while you're still shooting, you know, Tomb Raider and into post? And I went, you know, and they got me on a day when I was totally, you know, exhausted. And I said, you know what? I don't think I can do it. I'm going to, you know, I'll mess up both films. And they said, but, you know, well, this film will never probably get made then because if they go on strike for a long time, by the time we come back, probably nobody will want to make it. So I reluctantly said, okay, I'll stay on as a producer and then let's find another director to do it. And I'll, because I wasn't even sure that the script was ready yet as well. And of course, you know, Jerry gets Ridley to do it, which is, no slouch in filmmaking. No. So that was great for him to do. It was not so great that I, you know, had to step aside because I still finished the other film I was on, but it was great that Ridley came in to do it. And then after that, I was looking for the next thing, and I started to get a lot of sort of reverse bigotry, I suppose, about like you can only do big films.
Right.
And I saw all these cool little scripts, you know, going out there and never coming near me because they say, oh, you're the, you know, $80 million guy and you can't shoot on a small canvas or with a small crew and fast. And I was saying, yeah, I can. I said, you know, these big movies, it's just the number of trucks that are parked outside. When you actually shoot them, it's still five people in a room and me and the DP moving the furniture around. You know, it's not, you know, as big as you think when you shoot them. You know, it's just a lot of days and a lot of equipment. And a few years earlier, I'd been offered Phone Booth, which the whole thing was shot, like most directors in LA, had been offered it at one point. And I think everybody looked at it and went, that's really intriguing and interesting. And then, but no, I don't think I can do it.
Well, there's a famous story about Michael Bay wanting to do it and then not being, he had at the time had Will Smith, I guess. And then Will Smith decided not to do it. And they still wouldn't give Michael Bay $10 million to make Phone Booth because he wasn't that kind of director.
Yeah,
so I know. It was like $10 million for Michael Bay. That's like, you know, how bad could it be?
I know, so, you know, it's like reverse snobbery. So, after that experience, I looked around for something smaller and came across When a Stranger Called, and it reminded me a bit of Phone Booth because it was you know, a sort of difficult technical exercise. It was one actor who was actually a young girl, so it wasn't even couldn't possibly really be a star, in a house on her own. It's pretty much imagining a lot of stuff. I mean, obviously it develops into something else that isn't all imaginary, but most of the film she's on her own, just getting herself scared. And I thought that was a great technical exercise. And it was very small budget. So, you know, it could only be shot in a certain amount of time and very limited. And also it was a great exercise for me to say, can I manipulate the audience with one person? And really it's what they're thinking of, thinking that's happening and things like that. So I did that almost as a technical exercise to prove that I could do a small low budget movie, because I'd done three huge movies back to back, you know, I mean, without a break, really, you know, those first three, and it was kind of exhausting, you know, and I thought, well, I, you know, maybe I'll do a big one, then a small one, a big one, so I had to sort of prove that I could do a small one.
So does that change perception? I mean, is it,
yeah,
did it move the bar where you want it to move, or does it, or you have control of that?
It did, well, you don't have a huge amount of control, but it certainly you know, was good ammunition for every time, you know, I read something small and interesting. I had the ammunition that I had shot something, mm-hmm. you know, of a limited budget, and it'd been successful. You know, it made you know, good yeah. money. So, you know, it proved a few things. You know, I can work, you know, on smaller things, and mm-hmm. I can also still make them, you know, audience friendly that want to see it and make, you know, get people's money back for them.
Do you think of yourself as a commercial director, or do you just think of yourself as a director?
I don't like to pigeonhole myself, but I certainly think about the audience a lot. You know, I don't necessarily make the film for me and three of my art school friends. You know, right. I have heard other directors say, I don't care if anybody goes, I just make it for my three friends that I went to art school with. And so I definitely think about the audience, but but I do make them for myself, because I suppose, you know, I grew up in a lot of different types of films. And I'm sort of trying at some point to get closer to the films I grew up on or mm-hmm. really liked. And that's not always easy when you have an established career in one way. But no matter what you do, you cannot really, I've discovered, is you cannot really shut off your real personality. So what if, you know, if they give you an action movie, I turn it into a comedy. They give me a drama, you know, I turn it into, you know, put comedy in it. It's very hard to not put your fingerprints on it, no matter what the genre is, or even if you're desperately trying to make it in one way, it's mm-hmm. very hard to turn up what you really are.
Well, ultimately, I mean, Expendables 2 is kind of a comedy, almost more than it is an action movie. I mean, it's obviously a big action movie, but it's definitely very focused on the comedic elements as a piece.
Yeah.
Was that as true? I haven't seen the first one, God forbid I should say it, but I didn't see Expendables 1. Was that less so in the first one, or was that?
Yeah, there's definitely more comedy in the second one. And I think there's more emotion as well. That's the thing. I mean, it's, you know, there's a sort of tragedy in the middle of the second one, obviously, and that's the, you know, the instigation for the story. And so I find it, you know, I think it's got more emotion and it's got more humor. Some of that, you know, wasn't as intended. I don't think the script was quite as funny as the film ended up, because when you're in the middle of that and you've got those guys around, it's really hard not to do some funny one-liners or do some ad-libs and things like that. And, you know, just to give yourself something to play with in editing. And then, of course, you know, you start sneaking them in, and before you know it, you've got a lot of humor. But it was definitely very difficult to pitch the tone just right, because it could have veered very slapstick and could have been very, you know, a pastiche really of an action movie. It could be Tropic Thunder,
right.
You know. And so it's actually the hardest thing I've done, I think, to walk that line, to keep it one foot in reality,
right.
And one foot in sort of action and tension and that sort of, it's an action adventure movie, you know. But also make sure there's plenty of humor, because the audience just seemed to love it. But that's a sort of a thing you have to try out when you're editing. It's like how many jokes you put in, how many you don't, and the gaps between them, and it's tricky. And so it looks simple, that film, but it actually, I think it was like the hardest combination of film I've done.
Well, the celebrity of the actors is kind of its own other element to the movie that is kind of beyond. That has their own, it has its own standing almost in the picture.
Yeah, and I definitely traded on that, you know, because you know what the perception is of each of the actors and what they're known for. And so, again, it's a question of balance, how you introduce each actor, you know, and how big an entrance you give them, knowing what the audience knows about them. And in fact, something like, you know, Chuck Norris in it, he's actually become more famous since he's retired, really. And so, you know, I trade on that
right.
that I'm not really trading on his career, I'm trading on his notoriety since he retired. So it's quite, you know, without getting sort of, you know, too postmodern, it's kind of quite self, you know, referential.
No, it is, and it almost has to be, and it's successful, I think, in doing that. It really, you know, it's at times it's your head's just kind of like wanting to fall off its axis, but it makes sense. It does seem sometimes that you didn't have as much time with each person on the set as you would have liked.
Yeah.
It does seem like sometimes you're shooting around, you know, Arnold's supposed to be sitting over here to the right, and
yeah.
The frame never goes over there except for the single, and you're like, oh, yeah, I guess he had 2 days with him. And
yeah, yeah. No, there was a lot of practical issues as well with the film, which, you know, put me off to start with, because I knew, you know, I was going to have this actor for this amount of days, this actor in a completely different continent. I mean, Jet Li never left Asia. So even though he's sort of integrated with the other guys,
right.
You know, I'm having to shoot scenes one direction. I'm shooting Sly and Jason Statham, and they're talking to Jet, and I turn around, and it's 3 months later, and I'm on a completely different set in Hong Kong. And so that was difficult to feather everybody in. Mm-hmm. And you know, Bruce Willis and Arnold are only there for 4 days, but you've got to, you know, I've got to feel like they're in a lot of it.
Yeah.
And they're in action, they're in dialogue scenes, and so we're literally
there
running.
Like 3 scenes with Bruce and 2 with Arnold.
Yeah.
Split out, so in 4 days, that's a lot to get.
Oh, yeah, and, you know, an action takes a long time to do, and, you know, so there's, you know, plus the fact that we're shooting in Northern Europe in the winter, so there's only 8 hours of daylight a day, so, you know, it's tricky. So that one was, like I said, was the difficult, you know, the most difficult thing I've done. It was logistically and also tonally, and also trying to have a coherent story and plot that also takes account of some of the actors can't be in some of the scenes because they're not available. And so, you know, if you know how it's worked, you know, you can track it. You go, well, why isn't that actor in that scene? Well, it's because he wasn't available. So there's another scene to say why he's gone somewhere else. So, you know, it was a massive jigsaw puzzle. So the fact that it, you know, even plays is a miracle, let alone, you know, it's successful.
Yeah, you're kind of waiting on the Jet Li at one point, you get Chuck Norris instead, and you're like,
okay.
It's a pretty good play, huh?
I know, but that's funny, that moment where someone's coming around the corner, everyone has a different fantasy of who it's going to be. Because we put, you know, like the good, the bad, and ugly. So a lot of people thought Clint Eastwood was going to come around the corner. You know, so you thought Jet Li was going to come around the corner.
Yeah. I assume Clint wasn't just showing up, but maybe, you know, you never know in these movies. So how did they approach you on this in the first place? I mean, the first one Stallone directed himself.
Yeah.
So did he just not want to do the second one? Or
no, I don't think so. Because I think the first one was so horrendous physically for him. And, you know, and I was doing another film. I'd just done The Mechanic with Jason Statham for Millennium, who financed this. And then I was doing Stolen. I went straight on to Stolen with Nick Cage. And again, it was the situation where I was just finishing off shooting. And they came to me and said, we've got Expendables 2 coming up. Are you interested? And it was one of those situations, it was exactly like the end of Tomb Raider when they said, do you want to do Black Hawk Down? But this time I said, yes, because I'd sort of learnt my lesson that, you know, we'll make it work somehow, you know, even though they overlap. So I was literally editing the Stolen film via computer in Bulgaria while prepping Expendables 2. So I'd do a full day of work prepping Expendables 2. Oh. Then at night, I would sit with my laptop on my, and I would be direct contact with my editor in LA, and we'd cut the other movie. So it was like doing two at once. But it was, you know, I was intrigued by the whole thing when they offered it to me, because I, you know, obviously Sly wrote, directed, and starred in the first one. How is he about stepping aside? And they said, well, you know, he wants to be an actor on this. The first one, you know, nearly killed him. It was so tiring and just horrendous. And so I said, well, I'd like to meet him to make sure that, you know, he thinks that too.
Right.
So I met him, and he was exactly the same. He said, look, listen, you know, I did what I could on the first one. I'm happy to hand it over. You know, I think I've seen your films. I think you know what you're doing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'm just here for the ride. You know, I'm just here to have a good time. And sure enough, he was. You know, so I went off and prepped it. You know, worked on the script with Richard Wenk, who had written The Mechanic for me. And we came in and we sort of completely redid the script, also based on what I knew, who was available when, you know, how long I could have them for. Also, I was scouting all around Bulgaria, and I would find these great locations, and I'd say, you know, call up Richard and say, oh, you know, write this giant cave into it, because I found a giant cave. And then also, I knew I was going to have these guys for very long, and it was going to be difficult to, you know, manipulate them all. So I tried to shoot actually most of it on the back lot of the studios out there. So, and again, people think, you know, you have unlimited money, but you know, even on big films, you don't. So I actually used recycled sets from the studio. So they had a back lot, and they had a New York street, which is actually a really nice New York street. It was like a couple of blocks of a neighborhood in New York. And I said, well, how can I put this into a this film that is set in Eastern Europe, you know, and is, you know, and so I called up Richard and I said, what about if we said, you know, they stumble across a Soviet era training camp for spies to train, you know, Russian mole spies to go into America and to acclimatize them to the American way of life. They built this fake American streets and they learn how to, you know, speak American, how to handle the money. And so we actually wrote it in like that. And so, you know, my production designer sort of trashed the place because it was actually a beautiful set. He sort of put dirt everywhere and we got every old American car we could find in Bulgaria and stuffed it in the street. And, you know, then, you know, I've got a $5 million set in the middle of the film that I basically didn't pay a penny for. And the same thing with the opening is there's a big sort of battle storming this village in Nepal, and they had a street there, a sort of an Asian street or Middle Eastern street. And again, we redressed that and made it look like it was in Nepal. And we got very lucky with the weather because it was late summer, so it was really sunny. And so it looked completely different, even though it was shot about 50 feet from the New York set, because the weather had changed so much between the middle of the beginning of the shoot and the end of the shoot, it actually looked like two different continents, and you could literally see one set from the other. You know, and other things, you know, I found that the studio was surrounded by woodland, so I set scenes in those woods, and I put a crash plane in the woods. So I had to be very clever about, you know, frugal about how I...
Though it all sounds fun.
Yeah, it's great fun.
It sounds, I mean, like the energy you want to, you know, the kind of thing you want to do.
And also, what really... interested me was shooting a film on in a studio on a backlot like they used to do. You know, it's more like in the 50s, where everything was done on the backlot, and either sets or, you know, the studio exteriors. And so that was exciting for me because I thought I had got these great big highly detailed sets that we made even better. And it, you know, to me, I was going to get this great production value that we could never afford to build, and it was all going to be so controllable because I could walk from one set to the other and plan. And so, you know, with the director, well, it's all about control. You know, it's how can I control the weather? How can I control what the actors are going to do? How do I control the budget? Mm-hmm. And the more you can feel that you're controlling everything, you know, the happier you are. And so a studio shoot is very controllable. And, you know, we did have our other expeditions out into the wilds, but at least I knew 50% of the movie was controllable.
And were you shooting digitally or on film?
No, film. No,
shot film?
Yeah. I've only shot, all my films are on 35mm film.
Unwilling to go there or just
I don't see any reason yet, you know. When film dies out, then I'll have to. But
well, you have a lot of CG in this film, though, I assume.
Not a lot, no. This was done old school. I tried to...
Blood hits. A lot of blood hits.
Yeah, a lot of blood hits.
That was the thing that I noticed the most, during the movie, was every time somebody got shot, there was a phew.
Yeah.
Flume of blood.
There's
great.
A lot of those. But CG enhancements, I think, are good. And there's a lot of sort of invisible touch-ups here and there. But I try to do as much of the stunt work and, you know, an action in camera because... Mm-hmm. And it wasn't just because that's what these guys did in that period. And so it sort of suited them style. I can't imagine these guys on wires and, you know, a lot of green screen and CGI... you know, vehicles and things like that. And so I try to keep it in camera as much as possible. Obviously, there's some bits, there's a plane crash in it that are, there was CG. And funny enough, I had a plane crash in Con Air, but that was almost pre the big CG boom. And we shot that with miniatures. So we had these giant airplanes with 25-foot wingspans and small buildings with radio-controlled cars. And that was very old-school miniature. And, I loved it. And I wanted to do that on this film. But actually, it was just too expensive, you know, so that was the one section we had to do CG, and, you know, I really wish we could have done it as a miniature, because it would have fitted the rest of the movie so well as a, you know, everything in camera, even if it's not full-size plane, at least it's a, you know, a physical plane crashing.
So what do you take away from a film like this in terms of what's your idea of success? Is it that audiences enjoy it? Is it that you like what you did, or...
Well, it's a compromise on all those. You know, it's a balance. You know, you have to balance whether you like it, whether the audience like it, and whether it was successful at the box office or, you know, or critically acclaimed. And you know, I'll take any degree of all of them. You know, it's like if you get an average across them, it's never going to be perfect. You know, I mean, I'm never going to come away from film and say, well, that was perfect. And you know, when that does happen, it's probably the one that the audience doesn't like, you know. So you're always doing a trade-off between what you like, what the audience likes, and what, you know, maybe whoever's paying for it likes. And so it's always a negotiation either with yourself or with, you know, the people that want to see it or the people that pay for it.
So in the end, you're a bit of a pragmatist.
I'm getting more of a pragmatist, yeah. I mean, it used to cut me very deeply. Everything that I'd have to compromise on, either in the shooting or in the editing, it would cut very deeply. And now I'm a little bit more philosophical. And the more you do, I think you realize that it's never going to be perfect. But, you know, it's what degrees, you know, can you get it 60% how you wanted it? And I mean, there's a famous story, is that, you know, talk about making a film is you come up with the idea and it's like having a cup of, you know, of water in your hand, and you pass it to the next person and they dribble a bit, and they pass it to the next person and they dribble a bit, until it goes all the way around back to you at the end, and you're lucky if there's a couple of drops left in it. And that's sort of what filmmaking's like. You start off with the perfect one in your head, and it's how much of that perfection can you keep by the time it goes through all the processes and it comes back. And if you've got a couple of drops left, you're probably doing okay.